Turbo time. Engine time. Turbo time. The very sound of these words transcends their meaning. Turbo time. High speed time. The conquest of what is yet to be. The sporting version of a violence that is both epic and spectacular.
These are the faces, the surroundings, the lights, the places, the vehicles, the tools of the trade for those particular people who are best known throughout the sporting world as the track people.
Those flames from the exhaust pipes don't worry anyone. On the contrary, in the modern Formula One, they are a sign of nobility. They mean that the car has a turbine compressor in its motor. This is the day of the turbo, a time that will go down in the history of this sport as turbo time, a blaze of horsepower.
Track people are those who live the whole year round in the midst of engines, asphalt, and open air. Handlebars with two wheels or a steering wheel with four make an important difference not only in the style of driving, but also in the style of living or of staying alive. Niki Lauda, for example, has never been interested in motorcycle racing, not even in his early career or as a youth.
No, I never got going on motorcycles when I was young. I started right away in the car, so I never really got in touch. I had some bikes myself to run on the road, but I realized after a couple of times being out, it's very dangerous because these bikes are so nice, so you always try to go quick, but in the end you fall off, so I stick to the cars.
Lauda is almost always right, so perhaps he's right this time too. Even though in a Formula One race today, just as in those of the past, danger, accident, and fire continue to be a way of life for the track people.
Here's an example of how fragile the link can be between a driver and his life. All it needs is a few more members of the fire crew like this one at Long Beach to make the already worrisome reality a lot more hazardous. Another key moment in an accident, the rescue. This time, it is Arnoux who is caught in the trap of his damaged Renault. Often, even a fast rescuer can inflict serious injury through clumsiness. Wriggling out of the cockpit of a Formula One is hard enough in normal circumstances. Imagine what it's like in this situation.
Going, Rene. It could have been a lot worse.
At Long Beach, the California track, which once a year transforms this quiet West Coast senior citizens' paradise into a boisterous, brawling circus. Here, too, the track people play their part. Danger on display between old car tires and concrete walls. On a track like this, passing is a problem, and it's not unusual to see a real show of bad maneuvering. The champion of a spectacular mistake, Gilles Villeneuve, who captured the public by his mistakes and victories right up to the end.
Niki Lauda, the wizard of no mistakes, is, however, stamped with the harsh trademarks of his profession, a profession he tried to leave for 2 years without succeeding. After returning, he won again. No one has ever gone so far.
A lot has been said about Lauda, but for him, these are the moments that speak. The ritual of the podium, the champagne, the laurels which, for the spectators, evoke the highest pitch of excitement, while for the driver, they are the proof that he made the right choice.
Here are the other track people, the ones on two wheels, in leather jackets, on motorcycles. It goes without saying that motorcycles and motor cars are very different vehicles, but what those who drive them have in common is the rhythm, a special rhythm in doing things, a turbo time rhythm.
Turbo time is also motorcycle time. In the past decade, the motorcycle has become part of our way of life. Its commercial success, led by the American market and fed by Japanese production, has created an unprecedented boom. The motorcycle has invaded city streets, mountain trails, and desert tracks, and it threatens, on the level of the high-speed spectacular, the supremacy of Formula One racing. We'll be right back. motorcycle is a symbol of risk. A Grand Prix 500cc has a weight-to-power ratio equal to a Formula One single-seater. But while its acceleration is superior, stability and braking are not.
Hence the fall, the spill, the tumble. Silverstone, 1981. Crosby falls and the accident involves Barry Sheen and Marco Lucanelli. But it didn't prevent Lucanelli from going on to becoming world champion. Falling is all part of the game. It's bound to be when you're riding pure power, holding tight to a fine line of acrobatic balance. This is the speed at which planes take off. Another spill in Salzburg in 82 cost Lucanelli dearly. Early troubles with his Honda prevent him from stopping Uncini's race to success on a Suzuki. The new world champion is Franco Uncini. So Uncini becomes the new idol of the 500.
And what is the title? It is sparkling joy that bursts in a radiant spray like champagne. It was Nuvolari who said that. The world title comes at a high price, perhaps too high. For one thing, no holidays.
You're taking a vacation on the island of Ponza this summer.
Yeah, it's my first vacation since 76 after I won the world championship. That is, my first real vacation.
Your first vacation since you turned pro?
Yeah, it's the first time that I refused to enter those international contests that you go to make money. This year, I'd rather do well in the world championship. And as for the money...
Hey, sir. Can I ask you something, sir?
Don't call me sir.
Do you make a lot of money racing?
No, not too much. Very little.
I'll bet. I know one who makes very little.
I'm serious. There's not much in it.
Well, a boat will cost you 15,000 lira an hour. Okay?
Well, in that case, I'll see you in a couple of hours then. I can't afford to rent it too long at those prices.
And when a holiday finally does arrive, the title continues to be a costly luxury. Never mind. Noblesse oblige.
For Marco and me, it was the first chance to relax in years. Relax, huh? I'm his wife. I know him. I know what's going through his head. Speed. Always speed. Speedboats, for example. What's he up to? He doesn't know how to water ski.
Let him try. If he doesn't try, he'll burst.
Right. Make a virtue of necessity, and the opportunity isn't always available. So his love affair with speed is soon re-established, even on the water, and he enjoys a new experience.
It really is Marco's first time water skiing. Not bad, eh? Of course, he takes a few falls, but falling here is a laugh. Too bad the tracks aren't made of water.
But here's someone who looks like he really knows his business. Recognize him? It's Giacomo Agostini in his days of glory, when his face was the face of motorcycling. Water skiing is also a question of balance. And you do it alone, like riding a motorcycle. Just you and your craving for speed. Nothing else.
But the track people don't live for racing alone or risking their all for a victory. Rio de Janeiro seems made on purpose to satisfy the demands of relaxation and free time. A city where it is always summer is ideal for those who between plane and racetrack lose all sense of seasons and time zones. Nelson Piquet is right at home here, as are Cheever and his wife Rita, Prost, Pironi, and Andretti, all dedicated to filling up with tranquility before getting down to serious business.
Serious business. Andretti and Giacomelli don't look as if they're interested in serious business. The waltz has never been one of the qualifying tests, not even for the Austrian Grand Prix. This is Monte Carlo, fun and games at sea, fury and power on the circuit, in a race past skyscrapers, hotels, and casinos. In Monte Carlo, a start can often finish like this. This time, Mario Andretti was lucky. His Alfa Romeo had 200 liters of gas in the tanks.
Accidents are always lying in ambush for those who make speed their profession. True, they are less common in Formula One, but they can and often do have extreme consequences. In motorcycle racing, you fall more, even though, as they say, you die less.
Yes, there are less fatal accidents in motorcycle racing, it's true. But there are more injuries. Paralysis, broken bones, guys in wheelchairs, that kind of thing.
Falling more means a better show, which is why the Americans invented the dirt track. This is a surface which does not permit high speed, but does provide spectacular tumbles. And how? Sometimes the riders really get hurt, but that's the way it has to be. Broken bones increase the show's credibility factor.
What do you do when your bike starts to slip away from you?
Well, there's a song that says, "Let her go." But I still try to control it as much as I possibly can. Sometimes it's not the fall in itself that's dangerous. What happened here to Uncini is an example. We are at Assen in Holland. Uncini, because of a slight collision, loses control of his Suzuki, and while trying to escape to the edge of the track, is run over by the Australian Gardner.
After Agostini, Kenny Roberts arrived on the scene. King Kenny, they called him, a Californian who found America too small. He began racing at 14 and soon became the overall American champion. He then fell in love with Europe, even though he came from another motorcycling world. That's why he was nicknamed the Martian. Robert's example paved the way for other Americans. Mamala came in second in 80 and 81. Spencer is the whiz kid of the moment. He isn't afraid of Roberts, and he has never thought of him as his superior.
Then there are those who come from even farther away. Graham Crosby, the New Zealander who brought Agostini back into motorcycling. A lot has changed since Agostini's time. The motorcycle, the people, the sponsors, but the spills are the same. Asphalt is still hard, whether it's wet or dry.
But is Formula One better now than it was a few years ago? We asked Nicky Lum.
Because the cars have been so quick and too quick for the safety. I think this was the worst year I've ever been in Formula One. And thank God the rules are so changed that next year it's going to be better.
The 1982 Canadian Grand Prix. Another dramatic start. Pironi can't get his Ferrari to move. Other contestants manage to find a way around the obstacle. But from the last lines of the starting grid, already traveling at high speed, comes Riccardo Paletti, an Italian driver in his first Grand Prix.
The impact is extremely violent. The front part of a Formula One is poorly protected, almost fragile, and for Paletti, this crash means instant death.
Fire completes the drama. Extinguishers aren't much use, and the rescuers soon realize that Paletti's first Grand Prix is also his last. Too often has the relentless rhythm of the Formula One come to a stop in moments like this. But tragedy is intimately linked to the world of speed. At any second, someone may breast that tape which wins no prizes and brings the race of life to an untimely conclusion. Riccardo Paletti was 24. He lives on in our memory in the joy of his youth.
The show must go on. That's the old law of the theater, or better still, of life, which the track people know so well. This is Las Vegas, the artificial city, a theater city created from the ephemeral splendors of neon lights and colored bulbs. Spectacle, gambling, and risk are also part of Formula One, and it was only natural that the racing circus should also arrive here, with a Grand Prix which is run between the desert sands and the parking lot of a hotel designed in the style of an imperial Roman palace.
Show business and car racing have always traveled hand in hand. So much so that even a Hollywood colossus like Paul Newman can make racing something more than a hobby. Challenging himself and his insurance company, which is understandably worried, Newman races regularly and with some success. Here he is, fixing a couple of hamburgers and giving a performance as original as a scene in one of his more lighthearted movies. Gypsy actors, gypsy racers. The great Paul Newman has adapted himself well to this nomad life, and it costs him a good share of the millions he has made in Hollywood. This is the track where they run the Las Vegas Grand Prix. Slot machines stop gorging money for a couple of hours when the track people get out on the circuit. As usual, everyone is there. Stars, feature performers, and bit players, ready to give it all they've got, no matter how or where they race. Who says driving a motorcycle is dangerous? You just have to get your balance and you can even read the newspaper. Motocross. In Europe, there are 50,000 enthusiasts racing from place to place on every type of bike, trying to emulate the big names. In Italy, the sport is winning a faithful public thanks to several outstanding champions who, on Italian motorcycles, have dethroned the Belgian leaders racing under the Japanese colors. The real danger in this sport isn't falling. It's those little pebbles that shoot up from the wheels like bullets and can leave a very nasty mark. The World Championship is a tough battle for all categories. They compete in the 125, the 250, and the 500cc classes. There are three parallel seasons, with the most variegated terrain as a setting, from the sandy northern plains and the meadows of Central Europe to the rugged, dry Italian hills.
Two 45-minute periods during which you can never let up, with a bike under you that seems to have blown its mind. It requires real strength and physical endurance far beyond the ordinary to guarantee a clear head, especially in the final minutes of the contest, when the struggle grows even fiercer and the slightest error can prove costly indeed. Here is the winner, Jabour, a Belgian who rides a Suzuki.
This is a sport to start when one is very young, but the youngsters are always backed up by adults, naturally. How do you make your dream of speeding through life on a motorcycle come true when you're past the age? This is one thing children are good for. Dad gets so worked up, they even chase him off the track, but he's always there along with the other parents, suffering through every crisis with the kids. You can tell they're all revved up because they don't even worry about the inevitable tumbles their offspring take. He's back again, the frustrated father, like a pesky fly, wanting to encourage his son from a closer vantage point. Well, one way is as good as another to help your son win or wind up in the hospital.
Often take your little boy with you on your bike, even though he doesn't like it?
No, Louis Pierre.
No, he likes it. He really likes it, especially when I make it rear up on the back wheel. The only time he cries is when I go over 120 an hour, because he can't breathe so well.
But the car was not bad. Only over the jumps, eh? And I think it's danger in this part, in this special part. The next lap I go carefully, in the third lap I go carefully, the fourth lap the same. But the car goes very quickly front lifts, and I have no chance, no control over the car. And I think it's very dangerous. And all the other accidents I make before with saloon car or some small, it was the first big one. I have control over the car, but this was it was the first time that I think not about the car, I think about me. It's dangerous for me, yeah? And it was very crazy. Yeah?
When you saw the accident afterwards on television, what did you think?
First, after the accident, I feel not it's not very dangerous. But I looked the accident in television in the same evening.
Whatever your age, you literally fly through the air in motocross racing. But how about the flyer taken by Formula 2 racer Manfred Winkelhock, who has just described his incredible adventure with all the cool that goes with such astonishing good luck? On motorcycles, there isn't a risk of taking off. It's the landings that are always pretty abrupt. What should we say about Canadian rider Yvan Duhamel? 17 falls in his first season, so 17 becomes his standard score. And he didn't tumble any less as time went on. Now, after his worst spill, they finally persuaded him to stop. Dirt track circuits provide a racing style for those in search of thrills. The competition is so intense that some riders even use the bomb, a pill made of powdered glass and tobacco. The nicotine penetrates the organism rapidly through the scratches made by the glass and acts as a stimulant. The public lays bets and the racers lay it on the line. In these super-animated converted horse racing tracks, the huge motorcycles travel at about 150 kilometers an hour without any lane restrictions and never holding back on the gas. The circuit is usually pretty crowded. You can imagine the results.
All these spills make an impression, even on a consummate Formula One driver.
You know, it's easy because they don't sit in the car. You know, whenever they fall off the motorbike, and then they slide along on themselves. They only have to worry about their own weight, 60, 70 kilos to slow down. So therefore, they don't have the problem we have, driving with 300 and then go with 540 kilos against a guardrail or something.
Back to Monte Carlo in another spectacular and dramatic start. Daly's Tyrrell soars through the air over the heads of the other drivers, yet it all ends miraculously well.
At the start, the cars are close together, often too close. They reach high speeds very quickly, and the air is thick with the danger of collision. Visibility is reduced to zero, and just staying on course is almost a miracle. This is the face of Formula One: technical research, efficiency, and commercial ability. The best teams are, in fact, those that have learned how to work out the best deals with sponsors and have managed to float the massive wheels of their Formula One vehicles on the stream of dollars which seems to swell with every season. Are drivers born or made? There's no question that men born today have a feel for the wheel, but few have the natural gifts that can make an outstanding driver. Even those who have a predisposition for racing must also have that fierce will and passion which force them to dedicate heart, gut, and brain without reserve. And anyone who does not want to suffer would be wise to devote his time to some other activity.
Everyone has to do his job very professionally. Mistakes cannot be permitted. Anyone who makes them pays a high price, and not just in dollars. There is a tendency today to reduce racing success to a simple question of the superiority of the mechanism. This is an error. The vehicle helps, but does not create the champion. Nor should it be thought that an exceptional result depends on courage or recklessness. If anything, the opposite is true. Style, mechanical understanding, intuitive quickness, and that miraculous instinct which permits a lightning assessment of the play of forces acting on the car. These are the things that make a driver a champion.
Imola for another start, another thrill. Piquet's Brabham remains in the starting position, but the other cars just graze it. The Ferrari is a local favorite. After all, Maranello is only a few miles away. We'll be right back. though things weren't bad enough already, refueling halfway through the race increases the percentage of risk. But the show doesn't suffer because of this. On the contrary. The image wavers in the heat waves, creating a dreamy illusion. Formula One, the magic flavor of legend, a mirage at once splendid and unattainable for the greater number of aspiring racers. In 20 frenetic seconds, the car is refueled and the tires are changed. Once again, the fastest team are the mechanics in the Ferrari pit. Tambay owes a great deal of his success to this squad. For some, the waiting is useless. Tambay and the Ferrari win, and the customary ritual seems more festive than usual. The public, which has supported him even more passionately than ever, seems to feel as if they have won something too. For the track people, the crowd is everything. Today's public recognizes a champion, even if he does not allow flamboyance to be part of his driving style. The crowd knows that once the race has started, the driver of quality will surpass the others, not because of the courage prevailing in him, but through an awareness of his own strength, his ability, his art, and also his fear. As for the motorcycle fan, he really participates. He doesn't just settle for watching and cheering, he also travels on a motorcycle. And the motorcycle is not just a means of transport, it's a way of life. The fan himself is the hero, because he lives more intensely through his idols by identifying with them. His emotions are real, because they are lived every day on the highways.
Everyone on motorcycles. Motorcycles for everyone. Sounds like a slogan.
The destinations are always the same every year. Assen, Le Mans, Spa, Le Castellet, and Imola, the Italian capital of motorcycle racing. The excitement lies in living at the track for 2 days, hoping to see and maybe speak to the champion, to touch his sponsored motorcycle, his sponsored jacket, his sponsored helmet, to offer him anything in return for a place in the pits.
How did you get started, Franco Cini? How did you get your first bike?
Well, when I was a kid, I kept pestering my father to buy me a motorbike. My father was worried because I was too thin, and he said that he'd only get me one if I put on weight. Well, I heard that potatoes, especially boiled, would help put on weight. So I ate potatoes day and night until I'd gained enough to make my father keep his promise to me and buy me a motorbike. Well, he did, and that started me off, I guess.
Whoever would have thought that a few extra pounds of potatoes could have turned an ugly duckling into a 500cc swan?
For the paddock is already a triumph. You'll be able to say I was there too when Barry Sheen introduced Jody Scheckter. Jody, the ex-Formula One champion, returned to his first love, the motorcycle, as an organizer.
There are many roads to success, but the path can easily be, as it was for, say, Marco Lucchinelli, a Calvary made up of disappointment, delusion, discouragement. Then new hope, dedication, the world title, and widespread popularity to display proudly to a young son. And at last, the realization that success is never final and will not brook distraction.
Something I've always wanted to do since I was 17 years old, be a world champion motorcycle racer. I remember when I was a kid in my hometown, a town of about 10,000 people, I would brag that I could become a world champion. I told everyone, from the parish priest to the street cleaner. They all laughed at me, so it was a great satisfaction when I did, even for my parents, who maybe really didn't believe I could either.
The fable becomes reality. He, Marco, the youth we all laughed at, has been touched by the magic wand of success. How many other Walter Mitties dream the same fable as they wave the flag of their sporting faith in the grandstand? A scegliere di rischiare di non stare a pancia in su, tirando dietro me persone come te che tremano ogni volta che io parto. Chissà che cosa mi ha portato qua a far dimenticare cos'è la tranquillità e questa vita tua dentro la vita mia che ci corre davanti. Success opens 1,000 doors. Like King Midas, the champion turns everything he touches into gold. So why not touch the hit parade? The engine of a 500 hums, clash of shifting gears, and the whine of acceleration are music to the ears of the fans. Why shouldn't a racing champion sing? So Marco enters the world of the Rolling Stones and the Rockers.
In spite of the drop in RPMs from the 6,000 of his motorcycle's engine to the 33 of an LP record, Marco manages to stay in the saddle. The truth is that a touch of the magic wand is not enough. A little luck and a little brass are a big help in becoming a star.
You want to hear my latest record?
Did you just record it?
Oh, yeah, I just finished cutting it last night. Listen. Forse è stato meglio che non ando con te, dicevano le labbra della donna mia, distesa come un orso sopra il mio parquet, faceva arredamento dentro casa mia, partite poi soffritto nella vita tua, pensando bene questa non è poesia, non ti epi mai conobbi, non ti scorderò, e si soccava il naso mentre andava via, adesso sono solo che cosa farò, un'altra donna rincontrerò.
Puccini gives his opinion of Marco Lucchinelli's fans.
Marco's fans are almost fanatical in their devotion to him. They see him as an idol. They worship him, I would say. Stravedono, direi, per lui. Vorrei sapendo dove domandassi perché, un'altra volta solo che cosa farò, un'altra donna rincontrerò.
say that driving a motorcycle is harder than driving a car. If that were so, the transfer from two wheels to four ought to be easy for a racer. Nothing could be further from the truth. In actual fact, there is a clear-cut incompatibility of character between the two.
Nevertheless, there is a certain connection linking the two spheres. Motorcyclists are often tempted to continue their sporting careers on four wheels. There may be a specific reason, or just the boredom with success on two wheels, as in the case of Agostini.
Yes, it's true. I've wanted to try driving racing cars for some time now, and I really enjoy it. I realize that one needs several years to learn how to handle them well. Last season, I had pretty good results. I came in second, third, and fifth. Well, then I stopped. And I think I did well, too, because it gave me time to think, so that when I do return, it will be in the best way possible.
Nasty accident. This one, which happened to him in Sweden together with Barry Sheen, was probably what set things moving, transforming an eager interest into a possible outlet for a sporting career which still had something to offer. But to become great once more, Agostini had to return to the world of two wheels, which he did with success in his first attempt as manager.
Are you completely satisfied with this new activity of yours?
Yes, very much so.
Will you miss riding?
Well, I'm here, and I've got to let the others have their crack at the starting line.
And now Gianni Alberto Cecotto has his moment, racing full speed for the Formula One finishing line. After winning the world championship in the 350 class in 1975 at the age of 19.
There is no lack of other examples in the past. Four names that are part of the mythology of racing: Nuvolari, Carufi, Surtees, Hayward. But Cecotto certainly knows that the switch from motorcycle to car is no easy passage. This is a Formula 2 start. The excessive determination of the beginners can have these results. However, fortune almost always rewards those who risk the most. Almost always.
One of the joys of motocross racing is visual excitement at a low price, that is, at a low speed. Here, the spills and accidents can even be entertaining. There is no limit to the repertory. In the history of this type of contest, there are perhaps more funny situations than in any other sport. The crowd has to enjoy itself. That's what it pays for. And what they are buying is pure spectacle. It would be easy to be sarcastic and talk about a sideshow or a circus with the good guys winning and the bad guys landing in the mud. No, here there is real sporting value, even if a bit soggy.
Canelli, Roberts, Uncini, Spencer, Mamola, Sheen, the heroes of today, all relentless adversaries, but only on the track, where they have to fight to the limit to secure a good starting position, or to win an even better one in the order of arrival.
You only have to look at these views of a race, the rider's position, his posture on the vehicle, and the dedication with which every centimeter of track is exploited by him to see how he gains advantage over the others. Still, they sometimes find ways of kidding each other, even on the circuit. Look at this scene, which we will show again in slow motion. A joke that almost cost Uncini dearly. In an unsuccessful attempt to grab Mamola's exhaust pipe, he nearly loses his balance. Roberts, on the other hand, can wobble dangerously on his own without Uncini's tricks. But what class to keep the throttle open under conditions like this?
Success means never having to look for anyone. It means having infinite opportunities to meet, to know, to understand. Success means being able to choose instead of having to wait to be chosen. But success in motorcycling leaves Niki Lauda cold.
I think you can't really compare it so closely to say these things well. The cars have their spectacular in one side and the motorbikes in the other. I personally think that Formula One driving is a little bit more dangerous than motorbikes. I do believe that the 500cc motorbike is something very difficult because they are heavy and very quick. But I think it needs really two different people to do it. Some are brought up on the bikes, some are brought up on the cars.
As usual, Niki Lauda has every right to talk. Lauda has been through it all in Formula One. The victory, the fear, getting out, coming back and winning again. He knows Formula One's temptations, the real ones and the false ones. Formula One is tough for the old foxes. Imagine what it's like for beginners. Andrea De Cesaris, Italian, very young, is unable to hide the emotion he feels for having made the best time in the trials. To get accepted by Formula One, and when you finally realize that you have conquered it, that you have conquered yourself and the others, you are struck down by emotion. You can imagine how this same Andrea felt when, through someone else's fault, he found himself out of the race. At these moments, anger is not enough, just as it is no consolation to have escaped uninjured. Cursing and swearing are sometimes the only release for whoever is out of the race. Take it easy, Andrea. You don't want to be arrested for bad language.
Come on.
Champions a lot more famous than Andrea de Cesaris, such as Nelson Piquet, react a lot more violently in the face of such misadventures. As you saw, Salazar made a bad blunder cutting in front of Piquet, one of the young lions of the future racing world, and Nelson reacted with all the ardor of his Brazilian blood. Good thing that Salazar prudently did not remove his helmet. Class and cool, however, are obligatory for anyone who is stopped through a fault of the car. Here, Alboreto gives an example before an understanding crowd. Lauda joins him shortly afterwards. It is like a chance meeting. You here too? Sure, I broke my suspension. And you? Brakes, thanks. But Alboreto will have his day of victory with a kiss from the enchanting Diana Ross.
So he, the champion, becomes the man object for woman. He excites her, makes her more arrogant and bold. Franco Muncini cheerfully appears in the pages of a men's magazine, mixing business and pleasure. A commercial contract is a chance to have a new experience, to widen one's horizons, and to enter a world which, however you look at it, is always very interesting.
Franco is obviously embarrassed. Someone once said that a motorcycle is feminine. It is fickle, unpredictable, and gets ridden.
Then try taking your Suzuki to bed.
How do you handle all the temptations?
I don't. I avoid them.
Will you go riding with him?
No, because I'm afraid.
Listen, I'm a good driver, you know.
But I'm afraid. Besides, they go too fast
for me. Giacomo Agostini, so expert in handling curves, was happy to let himself be used in these operations, even if the Golden Bachelor of motorcycle racing had not yet reached the heights of the more extreme advertising tie-ins. The eye of the camera was simple and obvious, like the photographer.
Women, too, are getting into motorcycle racing, such as the 24-hour marathons. This is a Le Mans-type start, with a motorcycle on one side of the track and the riders on the other.
Associated with speed is the fascination of physical resistance as well as mechanical. One has to go fast, but at the same time respect the motor, which is almost always derived from a standard production model and souped up to over 120 horsepower. This endurance race, which is run at Imola, will go on for 24 grueling hours. At night, by the light of the headlamps, they go on racing. Fatigue is not yet showing its worst face. Moreover, in the cool air, the engine suffers less. As night wears on, the pit stops grow more desirable. An hour or so of rest which can be interrupted any minute by the sudden collapse of one's partner. Meanwhile, at the edge of the track, the smell of sausages tries to cover the smell of oil from the exhaust pipes. And with sandwiches and disco music, the crowd passes the hours while the riders on the track endure all the suffering they were looking for. There are plenty of sleeping bags, but they remain empty, perhaps out of solidarity. An orgy of wild dancing and rock music drowns out the song of the engines. It is dawn, the hour of truth. They have the weight of night in their eyes, in their heads, and still a third of the race to run, perhaps the hardest part.
Success may go to whoever makes the fewest mistakes, but to avoid mistakes, you have to stay awake.
What's the Le Mans 24-hour race like now? I won it back in 75.
I can't tell you. I can't even remember when I started. It seems like I've always been here, like in a dream.
And here is the only woman to have won a motorcycle contest valid for the world championship. Jerry Van Ruyen from Holland, winner of the Bol d'Or d'Italia at Imola in May 1982.
I wanna find somewhere I can settle down. A lively spot somewhere out upon the Milky Way. Another Hollywood, another Tinseltown.
Crossing the ocean is nothing for track people. Let us also try to make the jump from Imola to the Pacific Coast, to Long Beach. The starts are always the most important moments in a Grand Prix. Some are good, others less so. The rest is a matter of passing, of always cutting closer to the curves. They race with tires brushing and, needless to say, with some risk. This is one of the most deadly curves in the race, and the number of mistakes and bad maneuvers committed here is incredible.
This is certainly no place to park, and the driver is urgently invited to at least get out of the car. Thank you.
Another victim of the dreaded curve. This time it was Patrese's turn.
And here is the worst episode. Rosberg, with an incorrect maneuver, puts Tambay out of the race, just a step away from winning.
Here are Watson and Lauda on the podium, the triumph of two of the oldest foxes in Formula One.
Now it's the turn of the small cylinder motorcycles.
The most dramatic and most spectacular moment. The result may be everything or nothing, but it always happens sooner or later. Where, when, and how, no one can ever say.
Nieto and Lazzarini, champions of the small cylinder bikes, deserve a fame worthy of their greatness because they race on motorcycles much more difficult to handle. If, as is the case, the 500 permits a little leeway in handling, the 125 and the 50 will not pardon the slightest error. However, the fall, when it occurs, remains the cruel queen of the show. The merciless law of entertainment is fully observed only when something sensational happens. And there's no use denying that in racing, something sensational is an accident.
Few true enthusiasts who can feel a thrill of emotion at a curve well taken or at a break at the last possible yard, there is a multitude of casual fans who are only waiting for an accident, ready to appreciate even the mistakes in the drama.
The drama is almost unacceptable. More than 10 years have passed, but everybody still remembers Jarno Saarinen.
His style of racing was to quickly stick his leg out and use it like a flap, like on an airplane. You see, the leg works like a bit like a flap, a bit like a third wheel, and also helps you keep in balance.
Was he the first one to do this?
Yeah, Saarinen was the first one, I think.
Saarinen è stato il primo, penso.
It was this great idea of Saarinen that made him so daring, and I became a fan of his. I admire the way he raced.
His meteoric career ended at Monza on May 20th, 1973. He He came from Finland, and like Villeneuve, he brought to the asphalt the driving techniques used in racing on ice.
At Monza, he might have beaten Agostini again, but in the preceding race for the 250 class, he met his last curve. Many people had heard him say that he was afraid of the big curve. He fell soon after the start, along with Pasolini and Villa. Two of them died. He, the flying Finn, and Renzo Pasolini, perhaps the best loved of all Italian racers. Villa recovered. After that accident, there were a lot of riders who gave up racing. It has been said that for a racer, it is a good way to leave the scene at the height of his glory without the time to live on memories. But then, why did the racing world seem to die with them that day?
Pironi wins at the wheel of his Ferrari, and it was time that he earned the podium and the laurels. But Villeneuve, heading for the world championship, would never forget that sporting error. The two never spoke again, and Gilles would arrive at Zolder in Belgium with an extra dose of anger to work off.
The most real and most performed drama could have as a title Villeneuve, Death of a Giant. That day at Zolder, they were testing cars and telecameras. It was the last few minutes of the trials, the most intense as usual. It almost seems as though the cameraman, frightened by the high-speed contact between the wheel of Villeneuve's Ferrari and the march driven by Jochen Mass, was deliberately shooting an accident he never wanted to see. Most likely, it was just pure chance, a moment's distraction, which deprived us of some unique footage that would have helped us to understand the tragedy better.
But Villeneuve was a driver who was always liked in recent years and won the most races in Formula One. Because he took chances. We discussed him a lot, and they said he drove a little like me in 78 and 79.
Then you criticize yourself.
I do now, because deep down I always liked the way he raced and handled his cars. I criticized him because I saw in him a guy who could win a lot of races in spite of that wild recklessness that made him lose some. That's the only reason I did. Still, at the same time, when he was forced out of a race, I would turn off the TV set and I wouldn't care who won.
Quando usciva di gara lui in televisione chiudeva e non guardavo più la corsa.
I liked his gutsiness, his wish to win, whatever the risks.
A man indifferent in the face of risk, perhaps more than any other. And at Zolder, destiny awarded him a monstrously spectacular finale.
His roots lay in the quiet Canadian town of Berthier. His urge to come in first was nurtured on the snowy slopes of his country, driving a motor sled. His stubborn, tempestuous nature was very productive in terms of spectacle and results. He traveled around the world, entering people's homes with all his bravery, and their hearts with his unique generosity. Then again, much too soon, back to his own land. Friends of his world followed him all the way here to bid him farewell with the simplicity of resigned sadness. It is Jody Scheckter who says the final words in the same church that knew Villeneuve as a child.
For me, firstly, Jill was the most genuine person I ever knew. Secondly, he was the fastest racing driver that history has ever known. He went doing something that he loved. But he hasn't left us. Because the world will remember what he has given to motor racing.
He leaves a precious heritage of high-speed spectacle that will be impossible to restage. Without him, Formula One is already another sport. The faces of the drivers grow confused in memory, but others are coming up to take their places. The driver, the idol, is one alone, though he has a thousand names. He is immortal. The ceremony is coming to an end. The aggressive fragrance of the flowers oppresses the friends, stunned by the twofold awareness of a real tragedy and the almost dreamlike memory of a great adventure. And the floral color spills over the scene, red, like the color of his Ferrari.
Turbo time, champion time, the fusion of man and machine. Names that appear and disappear in flashing victories in a brief second, brief, too brief, like the passage of a meteor.
Turbo time, engine time. On two or on four wheels, the dedication is the same for the track people. The party continues, sweet and carefree, only in appearance. Those who join in the feast can win or lose everything in a game where the sky is the limit and the referee is luck, which, as we know, is capricious because she's a lady. But you can't merely play the game, you have to win it. And if the times, men, vehicles, and customs change, the search for the best is still the same. Turbo time, the track people, are expressions of a common language, an Esperanto of a people who live among engines, asphalt, and open air, the track people.
freedom rider, searching out a dream. Silver gleaming in the sun. Leather heroes, catch them on the run. Two nose engines high, riding into the wind. Motor burning, thunder of the light. Dust clouds choking up the air. Synchro timing, the thrill of being there. Logos flags away, riding on into the wind. Let the race begin. The fight within. Hold on to the winning game. It's a touch and go at first from the starting line. Cutting double time. I'm cutting double time. Switch to double time.